Thanks for listening to That Great Mank Pod. Please do us a massive favour and subscribe to this podcast. And if you can, leave us a review. Both are a massive help, enabling us to promote the people and the great causes we champion to a much bigger audience. If you want to get in touch, give us a follow on Twitter at Great Mank Pod and drop us a DM. Cheers.
You're listening to That Great Mank Pod, Greater Manchester's community podcast. Top one, I kid.
Listen, thanks very much, Ben.
No worries.
I'm Paul. Nice this is Damien. We're both co-founders of the Manx Spirit Charity. And That Great Mank Pod is our, you know, we call it Greater Manchester's community podcast. We're one of the 35 organisations, cultural organisations, supported by GM Culture.
Okay.
And as part of that, we have been running some creative wellbeing festivals over the last 2 years, pretty much from when the pandemic started. So we were lucky enough to have ours first one in Trafford as soon as the first lockdown was announced. So we took most of it online.
Yeah.
And pretty much that's all about going into, so that was in Trafford. We've done Trafford, Wigan, Stockport, where else we've done, Bury. And it's about going into those areas, finding the people that are doing really good things in those communities, some of which get overlooked, and we all know that happens, and just give them an opportunity to tell people what they do. You know, and we can share it across our platforms and hopefully, you know, create relationships that go on, and we've done that in every area we've been in. So our next one is in Tameside, which is the 23rd of this month, so it's a week.
Right.
And we can speak a little bit more about that as well, because we'd love you to be involved. But
yeah, sounds good.
So to start off with, can you tell us who you are, Ben, and what you where you are there and what you do?
Yeah, of course. So hello, Paul and Damien, thanks for having me.
Pleasure, mate.
So as I said, my name is Ben James. I'm the general manager at the Anthony Seddon Fund. We're a peer support mental health charity based in Ashton-under-Lyne in Tameside.
Yeah.
We've got a centre in Ashton where we do daily drop-ins. We have lots of peer support groups, including bereavement groups, suicide bereavement groups. We also do sort of holistic therapies like meditation, Reiki. We have a young people's resilience project where they get to do arts and crafts and talk about feelings, emotions. Mm. So that runs Monday to Friday. It's very busy. The drop-in's very popular. We have that on a couple of hours a week, and there's no... anyone can come to that. As long as you're over 18, anyone can come to it. It doesn't matter if you've got a long-term mental health condition, if you're fine, if you're mentally healthy, you just want to come somewhere and have a bit of a brew in a nice safe place. You might have had a recent breakup, might be struggling with work, any reasons. We have a huge variety of people who come to our centre, and it is exactly what it says on the tin, peer support. Mm. Just really informal. We've got things like a pool table there, we've got a games room. So it is just really informal, and trying to take that clinical edge off things that can be quite scary sometimes.
Yeah.
And then people are trying to access mental health support.
Can you tell us a little? I mean, you know, obviously, I know who you are, and so does Damien. We've come across you, and people saying good things about you as well. I'm not just blowing smoke up your backside there. People do say good things, and you'll find that, you know, we're pretty straightforward on that front. We're too old to be, arsing around on this. So, can you tell us something about Anthony?
Yeah, of course. Yeah, so. I say, luckily, Anthony was my brother, so quite good on this subject, I think. So originally the charity is named after Anthony Seddon. So as I say, Anthony was my brother. He was diagnosed with bipolar at the age of 18. Mm. From 18 to 30, he struggled. He was in and out of hospital with his mental health. A lot of the times it was manic more than low, with low in mood. But unfortunately, when he was 30, he did take his own life. So from that, my mum, Donna. Sorry about that.
All right.
Talking on. yeah, so my mum Donna and my dad Brian, they, lots of people were coming up to us and just saying about, you know, how much help Anthony was on the wards to them. And lots of his friends were coming up saying that he was always there was always something about Anthony that was a little bit different. So it just made my mum think there's something we can be doing here around young people and their mental health. And then there was also my mum, Donna, tried to get access to some quick support around about his Anthony's death. And we quickly found that there was a process. You had to be bereaved for a few years before you could get any help, or, you know, there was nothing where you could just turn up and talk to someone. Nothing locally anyway. I'm not saying there was nothing at all. I'm not... Any groups out there listening and disputing that, I don't want to think.
No, I get what you say, mate. I mean, all that matters is where you are at the end of the day, doesn't it?
Yeah. And so from that, we decided to try and raise some money on the local stall, selling secondhand goods. And we very quickly, due to lots of generosity from friends, family, local people, raised £10,000 for Tameside Alderman Glossop Mind, which is a mental health charity. With that money, we asked that they went into local high schools to deliver assemblies to raise awareness of mental health, the signs of that people may display of the mental health if they're becoming poorly. And so that money was used for that. It went really well. And I think it actually started to introduce what mental health first aid, which is quite a popular course for now. Up and down the country, there's lots of workplaces doing that. So in Tameside, it was a good introduction to that and getting it into schools. As we were doing that, lots of people were coming up to us on the stall, telling us their stories, sharing stories about their bereavements or about how lack of access to services when they were, you know, really ill with the mental health. So again, through that, we just thought we actually need somewhere ourselves here where we can set up a bit of a shop maybe, and people can just come and have a brew and have a chat, and that's it. There's no, you know, no waiting lists, no doctors needed, GPs, anything like that. It was just turn up, have a brew, have a chat, and we'll listen. And that was it. So what quickly escalated to having a charity shop with a little room in the back. We then moved into a bigger building, and I think we're on our fourth building now.
Wow.
In Ashton. We've just grown and grown. So our building at the moment has around about 16 rooms, I think.
Right.
Within the day, we're using 8 or 9 of them for peer support groups, drop-ins, customer support sessions. You know, if someone needs a bit of confidentiality away from the main room, we can do that. So yeah. As I say, Anthony was. It came as quite a shock to us because, I say, he was manic most of the time and in and out of hospital. Very, very rare. He was low in mood. But due to different things, you know, medication, he wanted to be physically active, but his medication held him back from doing that sometimes. So he'd stop, come off it, and then get poorly again. And it was just a bit of a vicious circle for him, really. He never found something that he could do. And he wanted to be doing stuff. So again, that's why as part of the centre, we make sure that we have a different variety of groups on that different people can access. And if they need to use us sort of long-term, we try and mix up what we do have on so that it doesn't just become habitual and boring and, you know, for them. And there's different things that they can access.
Wow. I mean, mate, that's amazing. What do you think Anthony would make of what you've done there?
There's bits of me that think he'd love it, and then there's bits of me that think he'd hate it because he's not getting too many attention. But in all honesty, I think something like this he would have loved, and it's a real shame, obviously, that, you know, it's come from something so tragic and obviously sad for us as a family, because it would have been great. It would have been great working here and helping people because he was always wanting to help people. He was that sort of typical, he thought of himself in a knight in shining armor. You know, if there was a couple of people fighting in the pub, he'd be the one that ended up trying to split them up and getting in trouble himself kind of thing. So he'd have loved it, really. Yeah.
I mean, what an incredible legacy, because everything you're doing is what he was doing and what you knew his friends reported. Even though he was struggling, he was reaching out to other people all the time. But also, mate, I mean, me and Paul, I'm from Clayton originally, Paul's from Moston. We know the area. And it's that matter of fact, you know, all the stuff you do is very complicated and very, you know, there's so much going on behind the scenes.
Yeah.
But bringing it down to that basic level of saying, if you're struggling, come in for a brew.
That's it.
I'm sorry, but a lot of the services that get well funded that are out there, like you say, if you're struggling now, you need someone to chat to now. You don't need someone 4 months down the line and 10 sessions of CBT. That's nonsense.
Definitely.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah. And I think that's where we really sort of complement those types of services.
Yeah.
Because, you know, some people might need some therapy, some people might need medication, but the waiting lists are ridiculous at the moment, you know, for that kind of stuff. But waiting to get that, why can't they just speak to someone and get stuff off the chest? And why can't, so we'd be nowhere without our volunteers. I must make special mention to our volunteers. We're quite a small staff team. We are growing as we get bigger. But the drop in our peer support groups, our volunteers help to host all of them. Lots of them with their own lived experience, whether they've got a mental health condition themselves, whether they've been a carer for someone close or, you know, just had some sort of experience. So they've, in some way, shape or form, they've been where the people that visit our centre have been, or, you know, they might not have necessarily gone through the same situation, but the feelings, the emotions, you know, the waiting for things, or the angst, or all those kind of things that are involved, they've been there. So just being able to talk to someone in that situation, you know, it's the cheesiest thing in the world, I think, isn't it? And it's very easy to say to people, just talk to people. Why didn't they talk? Just talk. But I like to try and flip that around, really. And it's about listening as well, I think.
Oh, mate, yeah.
You know, because people often are trying to talk, but we as a society, I don't think, are very good at listening. And I think the pandemic's kind of shown similarities between mental health and lots of people. If they don't see it or feel the effects themselves, they just dismiss it as nothing. And I think that's happened quite with the pandemic, you know, COVID, it's just a cold, it's just a cough kind of thing. And until it actually affects you, that's when people start paying it a bit of attention. But, you know,
people are scared of it as well, Ben. You know, a lot of people, you know, if you see somebody with a cut on their hand, you give it a wash and you put a plaster on, you get them to us, you know.
Definitely.
So people sort of know how to deal with something like that. Whereas I think when it's mental, I mean, I've worked in prisons, all different places. I've seen people in full psychotic breaks and everything. And I look around and other colleagues are absolutely panicking because it's so, you know, there's nothing you can do. Whereas the best thing to do is just stay calm and carry on talking to people.
And that's it. I work here. I used to work in a school. So I've got no sort of mental health qualifications or background. I will openly admit, as a young person, seeing my brother with mental health, are we allowed to swear? Not usually.
Yeah, oh, mate.
You said ask before, so I'm allowed to swear. You've opened the door for me.
You've obviously not listened to another podcast.
I'll have to catch up on it. But yeah, I was shit scared of mental health. It was what you sort of read in the papers or the news. People with schizophrenia and, you know, mass murderers and all that. And I'd go to visit Anthony on the ward sometimes, and I would just be scared of the people in there. And then since working here, it's done wonders for myself personally, because it's made me a lot less judgmental. You know, it's taken away that stigma for me. And so coming back to your point, it is scary because of what we sort of fed through media, through storylines on soaps and things like that. There's not very many positive messages about mental health, and especially mental health illness, long-term conditions out there. Which again was why we thought it was important that young people get educated around you know, not just about feeling low and stuff, but actually let's learn about some of those serious mental health conditions out there how to support people. And the more we do to reduce the stigma, the better it's going to be. And I think for me personally, and for some of the staff and volunteers that I work with, very know that ethos is teach them while they're young, because that's the only way we're going to create change, really. But yeah, it is a scary, but you know, once you get to just treat everyone as an individual, and as you see them and meet them, it's, you know, it, like you say, it's
speaking on your ethos, Ben, for people that don't know Anthony Seddon Fund, when you go on the website, I love the fact that you put across straight away that it's about peer support, that you're not offering counselling and other sort of interventions. But a lot of people who are listening might not know what peer support means, and it's basically just getting people together to talk about shared issues and coming up with their own solutions.
Yeah, and that's it. Again, it sounds quite simple. It can sometimes be a bit more difficult than that, but, but in essence, it is that simple. And it, you know, I call it a face-to-face Samaritans almost. You know, people think about ringing the Samaritans to talk to someone and get things off the chest, and that's what peer support is. You're just face-to-face, and you actually get to have a cup of tea, and we often have quite a good range of biscuits here and cake bars, which is
that's us coming in next week. Then
you're more than welcome to. More than welcome.
No,
to.
We will, mate. Yeah. We're absolutely love to.
But yeah, the peer support, and again, I think when people hear peer support, they think about sat in a room in a circle, taking turns to talk. So some of our groups are a little bit like that, a bit more structured, as we call them, a bit more structured. But our daily drop-in, which is sort of the main thing that we offer, is peer support, but it's like a cafe. It's a peer support cafe. People can come and go as they please. If you're new to it, one of the volunteers will show you around the building, have a chat with you, make sure, you know, see what's going on. If there's any further support that we might be able to offer, then we'll certainly do that. We've got good relationships with other local organisations, because again, we're well aware we're not experts by any stretch of the imagination, and there is, it's just about working together. And you know, we're here for people when they need to talk straight away, but we'll also help them access maybe drug and alcohol services or psychotherapy services, kind of thing. I don't even know if that's a word, I'm just making it up.
Hey,
sounded good though, didn't it?
It sounds good, and I'm stealing that on the next podcast.
But yeah.
Yeah, but Ben, that knowing your limitations as well, I mean, this is something we do workshops and we get involved. The charity's creativity and mental well-being. So, and one other thing, I've been a facilitator, I've worked in prison, I've done all this stuff. And the main thing is knowing your limitations and knowing when it's right to hand somebody over to another group or refer someone, or just introduce someone to somewhere, you know, for instance, if they're really into pool, introduce them to a pool league so they've got that extra support network, you know.
And that's it. And that's it. And we try to push that a lot, not only within the centre, but, you know, we also go along in the background to strategic boards. So we're on like a suicide prevention board at the same side. Donna, our CEO, is on some Greater Manchester boards, suicide prevention boards, lived experience boards. And that's something we try to push a lot, is that it's not just about getting mental health support from your doctor or from Healthy Minds, or, you know, Minds Matter services, those kind of services. It's going to your local fishing club just meeting people there, getting, you know, it is about, for young people, maybe telling them about the local scouts or you know, the local football club or something like that. We do try to very much keep those really small community groups in mind, because they're, even though they're small, they very much, as I say, in the community and look after people's mental health in ways that people don't think about.
I say all the time, I don't care how, where, or why men especially talk about mental health, as long as they do. So if it's in a pub,
Yeah.
You know, and that, you know, for some people, maybe that's not the best place, but ultimately you've got to start somewhere. And as long as they talk about and raise it as an issue between friends, even between strangers, I mean, you know, you can go into any pub virtually in Manchester and we're in, well, when I'm talking about pubs, I'm not talking about a pint of beetroot infused beer in the Northern Quarter. I'm talking about, a decent, and within 10 minutes, you're having a conversation with somebody and it's amazing how those conversations go. So, whatever. I don't think there is anything too small that as long as that conversation, you know, and it's the really important point you made earlier. It's that listening.
Yes.
It's, and I think some of that probably comes with age, definitely experience, when you can see that somebody wants to tell you something.
Definitely.
So, you know, let them say it. And the reason a lot of people don't want them to say it is because they think, Christ, if they do say that, what am I going to do? What am I going to say? I don't know. And listen, you don't know. You don't know unless you try.
No. I try to, you know, say this with my mates. Obviously, I'm a bloke. I like to go to the pub, you know, we watch football, that kind of stuff. And sometimes I am often the one in the pub that is bleating on about, you know, if we need to go to the pub for a beer and have a chat, that's where you feel comfortable, you can do that. If you just need to text me or something, just do it, you know. Yeah. Friends are friends, you know, it's, I've been affected by suicide a few times.
Me too. Mm.
And it's, I'd much rather my friend got rid of all the macho bullshit and just reached out to me than losing a friend.
Yeah.
And I'm sure if everyone actually thought about that themselves, they would. So, yeah, it's just about being there for people, isn't it? Like you say, listening. And using spaces, again, I think it's really important. Like you've just said, the community spaces, we open up more community spaces to allow people to talk and make it normal, you know, to talk. So, I know there's quite a good few schemes out there at the minute. I think, not sure if you've heard of the Chatty Cafe. And again, I think the premise of that is quite simple. They just put up a sign saying that they're a chatty cafe. And if someone comes in and sits at a table with that sign on, you know, they know that they want them to go and have a chat to and stuff like that. And real simple things. Again, there's a local organisation called Mentel. They are getting... So it's just,
I like that.
Peer support. It's,
yeah, that's good.
Good play of words, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. One.
Again, it's a bit like Andy's Man's Club. It's
peer
support for men, but they've got beer coasters out in lots of local pubs and stuff. And again, it's just making that normal and people being able to see them in pubs and places where you wouldn't necessarily think you're talking about mental health, but actually, that's probably one of the first places blokes in particular go to speak about it with the friends, traditionally anyway.
You just got me thinking there, Ben. I mean, I'm a season ticket holder at the only big club in Manchester, but we won't go into that one. And
can't help everyone. Group,
hey?
Can't help everyone, unfortunately.
Well, the group around us, and we've been in the same place for many years now. And while you were talking there about normalising it, I hadn't realised. I mean, there was one, there's been two people around our section that have had cancer. Mm. And everybody asks how they are. It spills onto Facebook with messages. We don't know each other. We're not neighbours. We only actually see each other at the match. And one guy during the pandemic, his wife left him and he was in a right mess. And he was messaging me because he sits in front of me at the match. And again, every time I see him now, how are you? And I've been over to Oldham for a pint with him.
Yeah.
But it's just you that got me thinking then how you wouldn't think that happens on the terrace.
No, but, you know, it can be anywhere. And I think those three words you've just said, I think, you know, they're some of the most important words, the how are you? And, you know, just to ask people that. And then if you know, like you, I think you mentioned before, Paul, about that feeling sometimes you get if someone they don't quite feel like they are right. There's something up. Just asking it again. I think there's a campaign actually about think ask twice. And I really like that because I think I am myself one of those people where someone will ask how I am and I'll go, yeah, I'm all right.
Oh, it's a natural, because yeah. it's pretty much, certainly in this part of the world, it's kind of, it's, you know, it's like an hello, isn't it?
Yeah.
You're all right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And you're not.
No.
Yeah. But then you say, no, are you really all right?
Yeah. Yeah, and that's it, and that's where.
And then you get punched in the face.
Yeah, you're on the terraces again. Yeah.
Listen, it's like anything, isn't it? It's the more you do it, and the more you feel comfortable doing it and asking that question. My kids talk about also. I mean, my eldest is 20, then 16, then 14, and they talk about all sorts of things that I never would have gone near at their age.
Yeah.
Because and certainly mental health, they talk about mental health. And they see it as a health issue.
Yeah.
Not as a you're a bit, you know, if you're talking about the brain, it's a health issue the same as anything else. And that, I can't ask for anything more. Mm. It's just the really frustrating thing for us, and I'm sure for you and for everyone, is when somebody gets to that point where they want to talk and they've got nowhere to go to, which is why I absolutely love what you're doing there and the idea of what you're doing, which is pretty much what Manx Spirit was set up to do. That was me and him in a Wetherspoons one afternoon whinging about, because we both had, you know, I'm not from the charity world, I'm more from the business world, and Damien's been working in that sector for a while, but from different things we were doing, and same organization, big organizations that, you know, get shed loads of money, and I'm not saying for a second they don't do good stuff, but they don't do enough good stuff for the money that they get. Because you don't see it happening. So we were just like, well, you know, we could whinge about it or we could try and do something about it. So I said, right, okay, we'll set this up and we'll challenge people as to what you're doing. And, you know, doesn't make us popular. I don't care. to be quite honest.
Yeah.
Because that's not the point of it. So when you see someone who's actually, I mean, listen, you know, the fact that what happened in your family was the catalyst for what you did, I don't think you could ever say, I could never say, well, you know, when you think that, look what you're doing now, and it's brilliant, because I'm sure you wouldn't have wanted to be in that position.
Yeah.
But, well, I know you wouldn't have wanted to be in that position, but to actually get up and do something about it, and help so many people, and all those people you've helped that you'll never know as well, it's just amazing. So what do you need in terms of, you know, when we do these podcasts, it's not when we do various podcasts, and 9 out of 10 times it's like, listen, if someone listens to this in 2 years, the content has got to be, you know, evergreen, and forget all that. You know, the reason we put these out is so that we can put them out, you know, today, tomorrow, during the festival, and people will listen, and it could be that one person that can come on as a volunteer, as a supporter, as a funder, definitely, anything. So what does the Anthony Seddon Fund Trust building need at the moment?
So just before I answer that, I'm going to actually big my mum up here, which is quite rare. So we're coming up to Christmas, so I'll send
you this bit then. I'll send this bit. You can stick it in the Christmas card so when she opens it.
Yeah. So in all fairness, Donna and Brian, who's my stepdad, they've worked tirelessly. As you say, it's not something we ever saw ourselves doing or anything, but they have worked tirelessly. I'm a member of staff here, so I can't sit and pretend I don't get a wage from it. I do.
Nothing wrong with that.
But no. But
no, Donna, absolutely not, mate.
Donna works 5, 6, 7 days a week, and alongside Brian, who does all our building work and everything, and they've never taken a penny from that. And as you were saying about that, pulling people up on things, Donna, I think, has got a bit of a reputation of being a critical friend or something like that. A nice way of saying that she, just because we've started this charity and we've got obviously an interest in making sure we get funding and things like that. She will make sure that she's always representing not just her own lived experience, but people's lived experience, and whether that's good, bad, ugly, or anything. So I think that's a really important point. I was quite shocked coming into the charity world about how competitive it can be.
Oh, mate. Me too.
Yeah.
Me too, mate. They don't talk to each other.
No.
They don't help each other.
Always.
Oh, it pisses me off. Mate, I'll be quite honest. It thoroughly, and I've worked with some horrible bastards in business, but they'll always see an opportunity if it's going to help them, and they can see that it makes sense to get involved. But charity world, mate, I don't get it.
It's not always the nicest, but I must say, in Tameside, we're working really hard at working together as local organisations, not just the voluntary sector, third sector, but also with the statutory services, so like the, it's not the CCG anymore, the ICB or whatever it's called.
The health services and the councils and everything else that support stuff.
Yeah. I think it's just really important that we do hold each other to account, but in a nice way, and try and, because ultimately we're all there to support people, and there's plenty of people about for us all to be able to support as well. And again, people need individual support, so what fits one person doesn't always fit the next, and so on. I just thought I'd agree with
that. But also on that, Ben, we say it all the time, because we come into contact with a lot of local authorities, with like you say, healthcare providers, benefits agency, all these kinds of things. They're people too, and they're struggling too.
Yeah, definitely.
And people can forget that you don't know what's going on in their lives.
Yeah.
And it's easy to say, we want them to work better, but the best way you can do that is by supporting them too.
Yeah, yeah.
What I mean?
And it's really important, and I think that's, in terms of Tameside, I'm quite proud of the way that they are starting to come together. As I say, I've only been doing this for a few years myself. I worked in education before, but just the way that they are working together. And there was one particular time. So we, unfortunately, one of our people, someone that used to visit our centre, did take their own life. And they did do really well known in our centre. So we were really worried about the effect that was going to have on staff, on volunteers, and obviously on the people that visited us. And the support we got from the local organisations, Mind, Healthy Minds, sending us counsellors so that we could hold extra drop-in days for people to come and talk about, the incident, the feelings and stuff, was brilliant. And that for me is true partnership working, is being there for each other when you're needed. No red tape, well, we can't do this because of that kind of thing. Stepping online, it was just pure, they need a bit of support, we're going to give it to them. So, and
they need to do it now.
We
need it now. Listen, everyone has procedures, and I get it to some extent, but it's not, generally, most things are not that hard to achieve.
No.
If you get the ability to work with other organisations, but if you just think them through, it's like, we can make this work. Or, if you're speaking to a statutory thing, it's like, listen, you can do this.
Yeah.
Really. And ultimately it's helping the people that you're there to help. And, as frustrating as it gets, Damien and I just, it's a big world, and we do it with charities as well. It's like, listen, if we can do this for you and we can give you this platform, we can talk to you and maybe open doors and work with you and blah, blah, blah. If you're like, well, I'm not really, we go, all right, bye.
Yeah.
we'll go somewhere else.
Yeah.
We really haven't got the time.
No,
it's really heartwarming to hear that happened though, Ben, because one, it doesn't always happen.
No.
And two, I mean, it's a basic Manc Northern principle that if you got to look after your own.
Yeah, definitely.
You ain't worth shit if you don't look after your own.
No.
You know what I mean?
No. And that's what I love most about here. It's that peer support. Again, it's just the people coming together to just help each other, and the empathy that they show. And,
humanity, mate.
Yeah.
Humanity at its best and sometimes at its worst. But yeah, I mean, everything boils down to that, just helping. And I don't like sticking people in boxes. It does my head in.
Yeah.
Unless we're after funding, obviously, in which case we'll do whatever we need to do.
Yeah, we'll tick boxes.
Yeah, we'll tick boxes. But ultimately, it's one human helping another human. I don't care if you're gay, straight, black, white. It's one human helping another human, and that's its base level.
Yeah,
for us, and it just simplifies.
Anyway, Ben, you got carried away then, bigging your mum up.
Sorry, yeah.
And Paul called you out and said, "What do you guys need down there?"
Yeah. One thing we're struggling with at the moment is volunteers.
Yeah.
The pandemic, we lost a few volunteers because they had to stay at home. Nothing too serious. Uh-huh. And I think the NHS stole some of our volunteers, and rightly so for the time, you know, they were needed.
Yeah.
And so it is a big thing we need is volunteers, really. And whether that is someone who just is comfortable enough to come and make a brief for people, whether they, you know, can do a bit of painting to help maintain the building, or goes so far as being in our drop-in and, you know, being a peer support sort of volunteer where they make sure people are comfortable as they come in, that they're settled, you know. So something else that we also do, we will sit, if someone is struggling and needs help referring to a doctor maybe or to a statutory organisation, something like that, we will sit and help people to fill in those sort of forms, in terms of referral forms. They won't just go, you know, this is where you do it, off your trot, and we can see that they're upset, they don't have a clue what to write or anything. We'll sit and help them through that. So volunteers, money is always a good one, isn't it? Money.
Yeah,
if you got some money,
can't help you with that,
throw it at us. But
how do you raise money then very quick, just to give us an idea, is it, I mean, do you still have the shop, do you still...
We don't at the moment. Again, during the pandemic, we couldn't open it, and it was still being charged. So we did get rid of it.
Lots of places did.
So it is something we want to start again in the future, because not only was the income quite steady, quite a good income, but again, it was a great way of getting natural volunteers who perhaps didn't want to work in the centre but wanted to help out. But then, again, just because of they would be working at the Anthony Seddon Fund shop, so people would be asking them what it's about and stuff. And some of them have progressed to coming into the centre and supporting people. So, fundraising events, we do have some contracts with the local council and ICS, I think they're called. We're part of a partnership called Safe Tameside, which is a crisis alternative to A&E. So we do that in partnership with Minds Matter and Tameside Oldham Gossip Mind, and that is for anyone who is in a crisis where A&E might not be the most appropriate place for them to go, so they might not need that medical intervention. But again, they're in crisis, you know, whatever that crisis might be to them, whether it's suicidal thoughts or, you know, they just really can't, they just need to get something off the chest or something's gonna happen. They can come down here, and again, it's just a bit more of a less clinical, more friendly place. They can have a brew, a bit of a chat, you know, like you say, a biscuit again. And that's with the other organisations as well. So that's going really well. So we have got some funding through that for the local council and ICB. So, but yeah, funding, we just different pots here and there, you know. It's a struggle. It can be a struggle. You know, obviously we've got a few concerns around the cost of living crisis at the moment.
What about your gas and electricity type of stuff there? Has that gone?
So I'm not too sure about that at the moment. I tried to stay out of that. The big boss looks after that.
I'm sure that'll
stress me out, so I'll let you take the stress out of that.
Have you noticed more people coming in, Ben, recently? Because, I mean, obviously, as we're in a, you know, every charity and everyone we speak to, we're all waiting for it to happen because we know it's going to happen. But I think because it's still quite mild outside and things like that, I don't think the reality's hit
Not yet. And I was talking about this yesterday. So we haven't seen. A few people have started raising it as concerns around what's going to happen because they're not sure what will happen to the bills and stuff. And if I'm being honest, I don't think many of us have a clue what our own bills and things. So
yeah,
we have got Teamside Welfare Rights have been coming in, doing a bit of a drop-in sessions to support people with that and any information that they can help them with or if there's any benefits out there they can access them, those kind of things. But we are expecting in the next few months for it to get a bit busier. People just trying to maybe get a few hours away from their house where they don't have to put the heating on or they can't afford to and come and use ours. And, you know, we'll welcome that. Previously, the past few winters, we've managed to get a little bit of funding that's helped us to put sort of like lunch clubs on and things like that.
What are they calling them? Warm banks, they're pushing at the moment. I do know that, and it may well have gone, but the guy who's on telly who does all the...
Martin Lewis
put a call out, didn't he, saying, listen, if you've got a facility and you can... I think he was trying to get someone to come up with a blueprint for it, but that there may well be pots. I can't even believe I'm saying this, if I'm honest. But it is what it is. But there may well be pots of money, and we'll keep our eyes open because we don't have a building. So, you know, anything that we see, and Damien's looks at all the funding a lot more than what I do, we'll definitely bear you in mind in that when we're looking around. If anything pops up, and get in touch, Ben. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. But if we see anything, Ben, if you need any help with anything like that, let us know.
Thank you.
But I am keeping an eye. I am speaking to it. As an aside, I actually support other charities and community groups as a sort of consultant doing all sorts of stuff, capacity building, funding, all that sort of stuff.
Okay.
And there's a number of places I'm talking to at the moment about opening up, like, in the morning, like community cafe type structures that to do exactly what you guys are already doing, which is people who are anxious can come in there, have a bacon butty, have a brew, have a chat with somebody just to get that basic information, advice and guidance and referrals. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, and that's how we sort of, we have tea and toast clubs, breakfast clubs and stuff, but anything like that, we always... sort of try and emphasise it's peer support first, and you've got just had the added bonus of having a bacon butty or a piece of toast and stuff. It's about being with others and share and just being in a bit of company, really. Again, winter time.
Do you do any outreach, Ben? Do you work provide support to other organisations?
Not really. Over the pandemic, the first month or so when we did close down we closed for a few weeks and they decided it was ridiculous and that we still needed somewhere to be open for
people. I'm glad you said that, mate. So many didn't.
So the first month or so we did a lot of work around delivering food, delivering medications to people, but we quickly we had to introduce a booking in system. Just so that we had safe capacity and obviously, the social distancing was being adhered to. But we don't do much outreach, really. We try to support other organisations as much as we can in terms of if they're hosting events or, they need a presence like that kind of thing, we'll very much try and support things like that. But most of the stuff that we do is from our centre in Ashton.
What I was thinking more is, for instance, I'm just thinking of a couple of community centres and things that I know. Because you guys, and this is like what Paul said right at the start, thing, you've got such a great reputation. We've known about, we know about the what you do and how well you do it. And people, this is from loads of different people say this. So,
thank you.
But those kind of places, I think, could benefit from you going as the experts. And I mean that.
And
just saying to them how to set up a temporary...
A temporary
drop in.
We do get a few people who come to us, and we'll have those. We're not we certainly won't try and hold on to what we do. I think there's a a local man called Steve Barton, he won't mind me mentioning him, runs a food bank, but does lots of other brilliant stuff for people in Tameside. You know,
what's he called again, mate?
Steve Barton.
Steve Barton?
Yeah, Steve right. Barton. He has a food bank in Stalybridge, but every Easter, you know, he does a massive big Easter egg collection. I think he got 10,000 or something this year.
Wow.
Christmas, he gets, you know, toys for and delivers them to local children's centres and families and things like that. He's brilliant, but he was really pushing for the town next to us, Stalybridge, to have a bit of a hub for people to go to. So Donna worked quite closely with him, you know, in helping him to set up a hub alongside lots of other organisations. So, and they have actually opened one in Stalybridge now where I think there's youth provision there. Again, I think they have a bit of just a drop-in for tea and toast kind of thing for people to go and have a chat. So yeah, we're certainly not against supporting other charities, drop-ins, individuals where we can. And that's something we'd love to do more of, I think, satellite kind of drop-in days, you know, at local parks or other organisations to support them. But again, sometimes it comes down to volunteers and just the having the capacity to do that, unfortunately.
Well, maybe we can, you know, listen, as part of the festival, obviously we'd love you to be part of the festival in terms of, you know, whatever you've got going on that week or anything like that. We'll let people know about you and what you do and everything else. But, you know, for us, the important thing is to leave these kind of legacy projects, as we call them, just with people that we like, you know, that have want to work with us and we like working with them.
Definitely.
So that we can keep on, because it's not about just a week and walking away.
No.
You know, we want to build these relationships. Now we can work with you towards maybe doing I mean, it's the end of this month, so it might be quite ambitious to do that now. But if we, you know, we could certainly work towards you towards doing maybe one or two of these satellite,
these
satellite things, and you know, it'd be great for us to pop in. I'd love to come in there during that week.
Yeah, please do.
And we can, you know, obviously within reason, you know, take pictures, speak to people if they want to speak to us. You know, we'll speak to you all about that beforehand, so that we can get that stuff out there, because that really works. And it is hard, because, you know, all the charities are struggling. They all want money and support.
Yeah.
But if the people, and the beauty of this is, so the people in Tameside, you know, if their attitude is, listen, I can only look after what's on my doorstep. Well, great, you're on their doorstep.
Yeah.
So you know, if that's how it pans out. So yeah, we'd love you all to be involved in that, and I can drop you the message on that. Definitely. And we can work something out.
That'd be great. And our we call them customers, we don't like to call them service users or anything like that.
No, I hate that. Clients. Yeah. It's when you call them clients.
Clients, yeah.
Think, so, no, they're not.
So we call them customers, they're not buying anything off us, but they're used to people visiting us. Again, we try to we'll let people know if we're expecting other organizations or maybe a bit of filming to be happening. We certainly won't just throw it on people, but because our customers are well aware that we encourage that, again, about partnership working and not just keeping what we do to ourselves, you know, making sure other organizations having a presence.
You need to shout about it, mate.
Definitely.
You need to shout. That's another thing you're constantly saying. It's like, you know, don't be shy. And I can't believe I'm saying that to people of, you know, from this part of the world.
Yeah.
You know, don't be not telling people how good you are at stuff. Yeah. But you have to.
Yeah. No, you do.
You know, whether you like it or not, you have to, especially when you're doing really, really good stuff.
You do. And again, it's just the more we speak about it, the less stigma and more people are going to access us. And and the more people that access us for support, again, it's a really good positive sort of roundabout in a way that those people then might go on to volunteer for us. And, you know, we've got staff members that started through coming, just visiting us at the drop-in and progressed on to volunteering and are now staff. So, you know, then that's fantastic.
Well, that says a lot on so many levels. Listen, mate, I know you're busy, and we both really, really appreciate.
Oh, it's been good. Thank you.
Your time on this. Give our love to Donna.
And
Brian, and really love to meet you all.
Yeah.
And we when you said you had biscuits, we were coming in. But now you've told us all the good stuff you're doing as well.
No, always got biscuits. But yeah, be a pleasure to have you.
Listen, and I hope I'm not speaking out of place, but I'm sure I'd be massively proud of you, you. Anthony, yeah. as well, mate. Yeah. So,
no, thank you.
You take care. Jot your line, and we'll definitely come in and speak to you soon, Brilliant. Mate.
No, thank you for inviting me on. It's been great.
Cheers, yeah, Ben.
Ben, cheers for everything you do for everyone, mate. No, it really is.
Absolutely.
It is. The volunteers, as I say, without them, we wouldn't be anywhere. We'd still be on the market stall, probably.
See, if anyone's listening and they want to volunteer at somewhere where you really appreciate it,
yeah.
Anthony Seddon Fund is probably where Definitely. To go.
And they'll let you know where all the nice biscuits are.
I mean, I'm not sure about that. Keep them in mind. In fact, they hide them from me. I'm not allowed, access to them.
I know the feeling, but that's probably my pre-diabetes or something
is
like that.
Is that an intervention, Ben? Are they staging an intervention on the biscuit?
Yeah.
You but, take care, brother.
No, brilliant. Thank you for having me. Cheers.
See you later.
Nice meeting you, mate. Take care.
You too.
Ta-ra, mate. Bye. Thanks for listening to That Great Mank Pod. Please do us a massive favour and subscribe to this podcast. And if you can, leave us a review. Both are a massive help, enabling us to promote the people and the great causes we champion to a much bigger audience. If you want to get in touch, give us a follow on Twitter at Great Mank Pod and drop us a DM. Cheers.
You're listening to That Great Mank Pod, Greater Manchester's community podcast. Top 100.